Hi, my name is Crystal Fletcher, and welcome to All About Canadian Books. If you missed my Behind the Book interview with author Beth Follett, I will put a link in the description box and also at the end of this video, because Beth talks about her latest novel, Instructor, and she tells us how yoga was a major influence in this novel, and you don't want to miss out. And for this portion, we'll have an author reading and also a little bit of wisdom. So for to kick off the wisdom, Beth is a publisher, and I know that so many authors out there, it's quite a journey to try and get published. So Beth, what advice would you have for authors?
Well, I think that writing is a job that requires us to work very hard, and as hard as we might expect our readers to work. And so it's very, very important that when the time comes to present to a publisher, that the work is excellent, free of error, of course, but also as strong as the writer and maybe the writer's community could help the writer make it. And I've had in my history as a publisher submissions that start, "Dear Sir." And I run the press alone, and obviously they had done no homework about the press. It was just a kind of toss away. And I didn't read those manuscripts because Pedlar is a very particular kind of publishing house. I needed to know that people had done some work. And if they hadn't done the work to find out about the publishing house, I could feel pretty confident that they hadn't done the work to get the book right either.
Right.
So you have to read and do your work and think hard and talk to other writers and read some more and read some more.
Thank you for that advice. So everyone, do your homework. Do your homework. Oh, so Beth is going to read a section from her novel Instructor today. So we're very lucky to have this little sneak peek. And Beth, before you read, can you share with us why you've chosen this particular section?
Well, I'm going to read from the top. Yep. And the reason is, if I selected bits and pieces to bring forward a plot line or something that felt linear to the reader, I would betray the book because that's not how the book is structured. Yeah. So I've chosen just to start at the beginning to give listeners a flavor of the book. And to get a sense that it leaps on occasion.
Yes.
And there is maybe some confusion, but it doesn't last too long.
That's true.
So shall I read?
Please.
I don't have a printed copy yet of the book. It's to be released. It'll be released on Monday, so yes. I'm reading from the manuscript.
Ooh.
So I'll read one of two epigraphs, this one by Adrian Rich, an American poet. "Forcing nothing be unforced, except no giant miracles of growth by counterfeit light." Mm-hmm. Section 1, 1988, chapter one. The day opens in bird song, a hermit thrush, sky above, lake below, concealed within concentrated shadow against pink light. Dawn chorus. Are you there? Are you there? Somewhere a light goes out. In the hour between wolf and dog, when a line of black thread held up to the horizon will distinguish itself to the human eye, Ydessa Bloom's husband, an experienced pilot, away in the North Country on a fishing trip, plummets into a lake called Baptiste. The search and rescue captain, a lake resident, takes it upon himself to drive alone to Toronto. There, standing uninvited in her vestibule alongside the police officer charged with unpleasant duty, he explains in what manner Ydessa's husband and his friends died. Is there someone you could call to be with you? The men ask. And yes, she says there is, but no, never. She closes the door without another word. Her mother Rose, how she wails and shouts and tears her clothes when bad news arrives, when any new horror falls. How Rose and her father, Sam, will wail, forced to do the one thing they cannot easily or with pleasure do, wait. In their Swiss-German tongue, there is a phrase for a wordless thought that arrives in one's mind, a sudden flare, an impulse not yet formed. One would say of this flare, there is a bird in it. The bird comes to her, go. She moves quickly, involuntarily. She assembles things one needs for a brief stay at a summer lake, cottons, linens, black lingerie, a sweater, folds these into a black leather suitcase. On the drive north, thought does not exist. When a thought presses in, she refuses it, though how she does so, she cannot say. The atmosphere in the car is the pressure of resistance in June sun. You scan your body from head to toe, looking for sensation, little pinches or twinges or aches. A dull, deep ache in your right shoulder under the rotator cuff. Another in your groin. A third, yes, there, quiet, but definite in the patella. To scan is your practice, a devoted daily observation. The day opens in birdsong. The years of your youth, years when you grappled with questions relational in nature, we who live next to this beautiful and venerable body of water, what is against us? What for or against the lake? Those years are gone. So much in youth goes unthought. So much goes unsaid. So much longing can break the mind in two. Some mornings you weep for your unlived life. Your dedication to the lake, to lakeside stillness and contemplation, to listening, your disinclination to adopt the traditions and tastes of others, your interest in inner life, have earned you rude names over the years, though name-calling matters very little now. You know how odd you are. You observe the lake as morning comes, its language of balance, connection, of weights and measures, feeling its way toward shore, listening to itself as it goes, making inquiry, sending waves into subtler levels of its basin, images deposited on the basin floor, from which will rise a sphere of forms to hold you throughout this day.
Oh, that's beautiful. Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Thank you. And to all our viewers out there, thank you so much for coming to watch Beth Follett talk about her new book, Instructor, as well as read and offer us some incredible wisdom about how to get published. Thank you, thank you, thank you, Beth, and best wishes with your new novel.
Thank you very much, Crystal, for having me on your show.
My pleasure.